Hello and welcome to this video. Here we are gonna see the rules of Claustrophobia 1643. This is a game designed by Croc and helped by Laurent Pouchon. This reprint is published by Monolith and will hit Kickstarter on November 6. It will be delivered 2 months later in January. Claustrophobia 1643 is an asymmetrical two-player game. In this game, the human player and the infernal player will fight underneath the city of New Jerusalem, built by the humans in the heart of hell. The human player will have a group of 3 to 5 Western warriors. Those warriors are for the most part condemned warriors, led by a seasoned warrior, the Redeemer. The infernal player will have bunches of troglodytes, but also 2 hellhounds and 1 or 2 demons, depending on the scenario. Now let's take a look at the phases of the human player. The first phase is the preparation phase, in which the human player will take as many activation die as alive warriors he has and will roll them. Those dice will have values that will activate the warriors and give them statistics for this turn. Those statistics are indicated in the line of the activation dice. The first statistic is the movement. Here, the Redeemer can move up to 1 tile away because he has a movement value of 1. The second statistic is the combat value, which means that the Redeemer will take 2 combat dice when attacking and will roll them. And the third statistic is the defense value, which is the value the opponent has to reach at least in order to wound him. When the warrior is wounded, the player controlling it will take a damage marker that you can see here and will put it on an activation line. This line is then cancelled. If in a future turn an activation die is put on this line, this cancelled line, the warrior becomes exhausted, which means that he has a movement value of 0, combat value of 0, and a defense value of 3. And his talents are ignored, and same as for the objects equipped. Those objects are given by the scenario. Now the human player may play instinct cards. Those cards have 2 sides. One that enhances the statistics of a warrior, and the other that can change the face of an activation die. A warrior can only have 1 instinct card at a time. Then, the activation dice and the cards are applied, which gives the warriors their statistics for this turn. If a warrior has such an icon on the activated line, it allows the human player to draw an instinct card. This card may be played on a future turn. Let's take a closer look to the warriors. Here, the Redeemer, which is basically the leader of the group, has 2 talents. The first one gives him gifts that are brought by the scenario. The Aura of Courage allows the Redeemer to enhance statistics of another warrior, and Prescience helps the human player while exploring. The other talent allows the Redeemer to enhance the statistics of a warrior only once during a game. On the Condemned Scout, you can see the Elusive talent. This talent allows the Condemned Scout to ignore the blocking rule while moving. Now let's see the activation phase. During this phase, the human player has to activate his warriors one by one. And for that, they have to perform an action, then a movement, or a movement, then an action. But they can never perform an action in the middle of movement. Here, you can see the Redeemer. He wants to move, but he cannot because he is outnumbered by troglodytes. So, in order to be able to move, he has to kill at least 1 troglodyte, not to be outnumbered anymore. So he performs first combat action and kills a troglodyte. He can now move. He can either move to an adjacent tile or explore a new tile. For that, the tile he is on has to have an opening like this. And the warrior may then explore. Then the infernal player takes the first tile of the pile and puts it the way he wants. The warrior is then put on this new tile, and be careful, here is the occupation limit of the tiles. This number corresponds to the number of players of each side that can be on the tile at the same time. It can never be outreached. You can also see icons like this. Those icons indicate the effects of the tiles, if they have one. Now let's take a look at the phases of the infernal player, starting with the preparation phase. In this phase, the infernal player will take three destiny dice and rolls them. Those dice have values going from 1 to 3 and colors, red and white. With those dice, the infernal player will be able to activate powers. Those powers are on the destiny board and have trigger conditions and effects. The Abyssal Threat power requires at least one die to be activated, but there can be more. If there are more dice put here, all of the dice needs to be of the same color, so either white or red. When activated, this power gives the infernal player 3 threat points per die put here. Threat points are represented by Prima Materia gems. Those gems represent 1 threat point for the small ones and 3 threat points for the big ones. The Dark Destiny power allows the infernal player to draw even cards. When activated, the infernal player will draw an amount of cards equal to the value on the die put here. But then the infernal player may only keep one card among them and will discard the rest. The power Supernatural Speed will enhance troglodytes. If the condition is met, which is to put 2 white dice here, all the troglodytes will get an extra movement for this turn. The same goes for frenzied creatures. It needs 2 red dice this time to be activated. And when activated, all the troglodytes become frenzy. Frenzy means that the troglodytes are better in combat. And as you can see, here I only put 1 red die, and the condition is to put 2 red dice, which means that this die will stay here for the future turns, and it will be easier for the infernal player to activate this power. There is also Intrepid Charge and Sneaky Charge. Those powers allow the infernal player to bring more easily the warriors into play. Okay, now let's see the threat phase. During this phase, the demon is allowed to spend threat points in order to bring warriors into play. But for that, 2 conditions must be met. The first one is that the tile on which the warrior is brought must be empty of enemy warriors. So this tile is okay, but this is not, because on this one there is the Redeemer, which is a human warrior. And the second condition is that the tile must have an opening, like this or that. But this tile doesn't have an opening, so this warrior cannot be brought here. The warriors cost threat points, as we said. Troglodytes each cost 1 threat point. There is 11 troglodytes in total, but during the game, the infernal player may bring as many troglodytes as he wanted to play. There is also the Hellhounds. They each cost 3 threat points. And when a Hellhound is brought into play for the first time, the infernal player is allowed to take a destiny die from his reserve and assign it on the face of his choice to the Hellhound. Then the statistics of the Hellhound are enhanced, and it may also get talents for this turn, but for future turns. If the Infernal player wants the Hellhound to have enhanced statistics, he will then need to take the Destiny die among the three Destiny dice he rolled during the preparation phase. And last but not least, there is the Demon. The Demon costs 5 threat points to enter the game. The Demon that enters is dictated by the scenario, and the number of times this Demon can enter the game is also dictated by the scenario. On the Demon board, you can see the statistics of this Demon and its ability. And you can also see a power brought by this Demon. This power will be added to the powers of the Board of Destiny, and this power is available even if the Demon is not into play. Okay, let's jump to the activation phase, which is exactly the same as the human player's activation phase, which means that the Infernal player must activate all of its miniatures one by one, making them perform either an action then a movement, or a movement then an action. And now you know how to play Claustrophobia 1643, so I invite you to go watch a game played on another video of ours. See you soon!